Hello, today we are here to discuss about plaque control, various methods of plaque control, mechanical and chemical methods of plaque control and various techniques by which these control methods can be used. Now before going into the depth, let us know what is plaque control. Plaque control is the removal of the microbial plaque and thus prevention of its accumulation on the supragingival surfaces and adjacent gingival tissues. Now, what is the rationale of plaque control? Why plaque control is required? Plaque control is required to control the periodontal disease by regular removal of plaque and thus prevent the supragingival plaque accumulation and because if the supragingival plaque is left undisturbed, then it will result in accumulation of pathogenic bacteria. Various approaches for plaque control are mechanical methods and chemical methods. What are the mechanical methods? In mechanical methods, plaque control can be done by an individual, means by the patient himself, and the professional, by the doctor. The individual plaque control methods, mechanical plaque control methods include toothbrushing, flossing, interdental brushes. Professionally, plaque can be removed by hand instruments and ultrasonic instruments. Chemical plaque control methods by individual is with the use of mouthwash, and professionally by tooth pumicing and polishing. Now let us see some of the methods of mechanical plaque removal by an individual. The first method is by toothbrushing. Toothbrushing can be done manually with the by an individual or by using a powered or battery operated toothbrush. The second method is by the use of interdental aids. Interdental aids can be used as an adjunct to toothbrushing. They cannot be used as a substitute, but they can be used along with toothbrushing. The interdental aids used are dental floss. The dental floss may be waxed or unwaxed. In most of the cases, we use unwaxed toothbrush, dental floss. However, if there are very tight contacts present, only in those cases, we have to use waxed dental floss. The second type of interdental aid is triangular toothpicks. The triangular toothpicks may be hand-handled or with the Proxa pick. The third is with the help of interdental brushes. The interdental brush includes Proxa brush and bottle brushes, and the remaining are yarns, gauze strips and pipe cleaners. Other methods or mechanical methods of plaque control are with the help of rubber tip stimulator that stimulates the gingiva and do gingival massage. And the second method is with the help of water jets. Water jets or water irrigators remove the supragingival plaque and the plaque which is accumulated below the gingiva with the help of pulsating water jet. Chemical plaque control. The chemical plaque controlling agents can be supplied in the form of mouthwash, which is the most effective and most commonly used method, in the forms of chewable tablets or lozenges. Mostly we give chemical plaque control in the form of mouthwash. Now, chemical plaque controlling agents are divided into three generations. The first generation agents include antibiotics, phenol, quaternary ammonium compounds, sanguinarin, etc. The second generation compounds include bisbiguanide, that is chlorhexidine. Chlorhexidine is the gold standard for chemical plaque control. And the third generation includes delmopinol. Chemical plaque control cannot be used as a substitute to mechanical plaque control. It has to be used as an adjunct to mechanical plaque control. Now, various indications for chemical plaque control are: it is used after periodontal surgeries to reduce inflammation. In patients who are poorly motivated or in non-compliant patients, it has to be used in medically compromised patients. As a prophylactic, it can be used after scaling and root planing, in cases of gingival enlargement, in patients on orthodontic appliances and in mentally and physically handicapped patients. So let us discuss the various parts of a toothbrush. A toothbrush consists of the head. This is the head portion. It consists of the neck or the shank portion. This is the handle and this is the cap of the brush. Now, in this brush, there are various bristles. When various bristles are bundled together, it is known as a tuft. So, A toothbrush consists of various tufts which are bundled to, when bristles are bundled together, it constitutes a tuft. A tuft is a bundle of bristles. Now in a toothbrush, in the head of the toothbrush, there are two to four rows of tufts. These are the bundles of bristles which are known as tufts. In each brush, there are 2 to 4 rows of tufts, and in each row, there may be 6 to 12 tufts. So now the upper portion of this head of the brush is known as the toe, and the lower portion, this portion, it is known as the heel of the brush. The handle of the brush may be thick or thin. Mostly thick handled toothbrush are preferred because they can be better maneuverated. The handle may be straight or contra-angled. The contra-angled toothbrushes are more preferred because of the more accessibility and the reach of the brushes. The brush head may be long or short. It is always preferable to use short head toothbrushes because they can reach the most posterior part and the lingual sides of the mouth very easily. The bristles of the brush may be made up of natural or artificial bristles. The natural bristles are made from hog's hair or pig's hair. The disadvantages of the bristles made from hog's hair are they can fray easily, break easily, they are more soft, they can be contaminated very easily, and they are very less elastic. To combat the disadvantages of natural bristles, artificial filament bristles have been developed, and these artificial filaments are made up of nylon, which are superior to the natural bristles. Now these bristles, when they are grouped together, they are known as tufts, and as we have already studied, tufts are arranged in a brush head in 2 to 4 rows, and in each row there might be 5 to 12 tufts. The brush may be unitufted or multi-tufted, and the hardness of the bristle is directly proportional to the square of the diameter of the bristle and inversely proportional to the length of the bristle. This means if the diameter of the bristle is increased, the hardness will increase, and if the length of the bristle is increased, then its hardness will decrease. This you have to remember. This might be sometimes asked in MCQs. Now let us see the various types of brushes that are used. These brushes are divided based upon their diameter. As we have already studied, as the diameter decreases, the softness of the brush increases. So the ultra soft toothbrush has the least diameter. The diameter is 0.075 mm. The soft brush has diameter of 0.2 mm. Medium and hard bristle brushes have diameter of 0.3 mm and 0.4 mm respectively. Now, ADA has given a specification for designing a toothbrush. These specifications are as follows. The brush length should be 1 to 1.25 inches. The width of the brush should be between 5 by 16 to 3 by 8 inches. As we have studied these two points, the rows in which the tufts of the brush are arranged should be 2 to 4, and the bristles and the tufts in each row should be between 5 to 12. The surface area of the brush should be between 25.4 to 31.6 mm long. Now, let us have an overview of the historical background of how the toothbrush is developed. Initially, twigs of the aromatic plants and barks of the trees like arak trees in the form of miswak was used. First modern toothbrushes were invented by Chinese, and in the year 1900, cellulite plastic brushes with bone handles were developed. During World War II, nylon bristles were introduced. The powered toothbrushes. Powered toothbrushes, also known as electrically driven or battery operated toothbrushes, were first designed in the year 1939. These brushes mimic the back and forth motion and the vibratory motions of modified bars technique, which is the proper technique to do brushing. This method relies completely on the mechanical contact between the surfaces of the tooth and the bristles to remove the plaque. When compared to the manual toothbrushes, power-driven toothbrushes reduce plaque by 7% and they decrease gingival bleeding by 17%. let us see the indications of power toothbrushes. Power toothbrushes are very useful in small children, in patients who lack fine motor skills or lack manual dexterity, in patients who are medically compromised and are hospitalized. They can be used even by general population who prefer to use power toothbrush because they are anytime better than manual toothbrushes. They can be used in patients with orthodontic appliances. Now, let us see that how frequently we should brush and how frequently we should change our brushes. The frequency of brushing should be twice daily, means every 12 hours we should brush our teeth, and we should change our brush every 3 months. ADA has given, according to ADA, if proper brushing technique is followed, then 2 minutes brushing, if proper technique is followed, is sufficient to clean the teeth and to make the gingiva healthy. For ideal plaque control, toothbrushes should always be supplemented with interdental cleaning devices. Various interdental cleaning devices which can be used based on the types of embrasures are wooden tips, plastic tips and interdental brushes. Now, how can we decide that which sort of interdental cleaning devices should be used in which type of embrasures? We have explained these different types of embrasures and different types of interdental cleaning devices which should be used in this diagram. If type 1 embrasure is present, what is type 1 embrasure? Type 1 embrasure is mostly present in the healthy gums. There is no gingival recession completely. The gingival embrasure is completely covered by the interdental papilla. In such cases, we can use dental floss. This indicates a healthy gingiva. In type 2 embrasures, what happens is the interdental papilla has recessed, but it is above the CEJ and below the contact point. So, the interdental brushes can be used in these cases. In type 3 gingiva, where there is complete loss of interdental papilla, the interdental tip is below the CEJ. It is below the contact point and below the CEJ, and there is also exposure of the root. In such cases, in unit tufted brushes should be used. So these are the indications of different types of interdental cleaning devices should be used in which types of embrasures. Now let us see some of the important points regarding dental floss. Dental floss is the most commonly recommended method to remove the plaque from the interdental areas. Mostly dental floss is used in type 1 embrasures. The types of different dental flosses are twisted or non-twisted, or they can be said as braided or non-braided. Mostly preferred are the non-braided or non-twisted types. The second variety is bonded and non-bonded. Third is waxed and unwaxed. These waxed dental flosses should be used wherever there are tight contacts present, because it is very difficult for the unwaxed dental floss to pass these tight contacts because of the friction that develops. And unwaxed dental floss can be recommended in normal contact tooth, tooth having normal contact. The fourth variety is thick and thin. Similarly, the thin variety of dental floss is used in patients with tight contacts and thick variety in patients with normal contacts. Let us have a look at this unwaxed dental floss. Unwaxed dental floss is usually recommended in patients with normal tooth contacts. This we have already seen. And waxed is recommended in patients with tight contacts, because thick floss may cause difficulty to pass through the tight contacts. Levi Speer Palmley is the dentist who invented dental floss. Recently, powered flosses have also come into market. And also floss holders are available in the market. These floss holders are reusable. They are made up of plastic and they can be discarded after a week or two. They are lightweight and they can be cleaned easily. In this, the floss can be put at the tips of this floss holder and then it can be used. And it is very easy for the patients to use such types of floss. We can use a floss by two methods. One is the spool method and the other is the loop or circular method. Spool method is mostly used in the patients who have a good muscular control. Such patients include teenagers and adults with good muscular control. Loop or circular methods is used in the patients who lack manual dexterity and in children. So, let us see one by one the procedure of spool and loop method. What happens in spool method is a 17 inches floss is taken and then we have to wind it around our middle fingers. We have to hold the floss with the thumb and the index finger and guide it through the interproximal areas in a seesaw motion up and down. This way the plaque from the proximal areas can be easily removed in the spool method. Now in the loop method also, we have to take a 17 inches floss, tie it at its end with 2 to 3 knots. In this, we have to put all our fingers in the loop and hold the floss. The thumb is kept outside the loop. We just have to put the 4 fingers inside the loop. We don't have to put the thumb. Now with the help of index fingers, the floss is guided in the lower teeth, and with the help of this thumb, we have to guide the floss into the upper teeth. And in this way, the proximal areas can be cleaned with loop or circular method. Interdental brushes may be of cone-shaped or cylindrical shape. There are two types of interdental brushes that are available. They are single tufted brushes, which we have seen earlier are used in type 3M bridges, and small conical tooth brushes, which can be used in type 2 embrasures. Thus, these two types of interdental brushes are mainly used to clean large irregular concave surfaces of the tooth so that the plaque in these areas can be easily removed. In 1872, Silas Noble and J.P. Cooley were the scientists who first patented the toothpick manufacturing machine. The key difference between a toothpick and a wood stick is that the body of the toothpick is circular, while the body of the wood stick is triangular or wedge-shaped. Let us see how wood sticks are used. In the wood sticks, the triangular or the base of the triangle should be kept towards the gingiva when it is inserted, and the tip of the wood stick should be pointing occlusally and incisally, and then it should be inserted into the embrasure area or the interdental area to clean whatever is stuck between the teeth. Let us discuss few important questions of this topic. The first question is, water irrigating devices are most useful in? The options are, number one, in removing the plaque. No, water irrigating devices by itself cannot remove the plaque. For plaque removal, we need manual brushing technique or ultrasonic devices or periodontal instruments to clean the plaque. The second option is preventing plaque formation. Water irrigating devices cannot prevent the plaque formation. They only can detoxify the bacteria. So, this option we can negate out. The third option is for diluting the bacterial products. Yes, this might be the answer. Let us first look what is the fourth option. The fourth option is reducing the periodontal pocket. No, water irrigating devices are most useful. Most useful. They help in reducing the pocket by removing the bacterial products, but they do not reduce the pocket by themselves. So this cannot be the answer. The option third, diluting bacterial products. What happened with water irrigating devices is, water irrigating devices, they dislodge the bacteria which are attached to the plaque, and also they detoxify the bacterial products. If water irrigating devices are in this water irrigating devices, if we mix chlorhexidine and water, then it most effectively can be used to irrigate the periodontal pockets also. Thus, water irrigating devices are most useful in diluting bacterial products. The answer to this question is number 3. Let us look at the second question. The question is, the most preferred type of dental floss is? The most preferred type of dental floss is? Options are, number 1, unwaxed and thin floss. Yes, unwaxed floss, as we have already studied, is the most preferred type of floss. So, unwaxed can be the answer. And thin floss. Yes, thin floss passes easily between the tight contacts. So, this might be the answer. First, let us look at all the options. The second option is unwaxed and thick floss. Unwaxed floss is preferable, but thick floss cannot pass between the tight contacts, tight tooth contacts. So, this cannot be the answer. The third option is waxed and thin floss. We all know that waxed is preferable only in the cases of where very tight contacts are present. So, this cannot be the answer. And waxed and thick floss also cannot be the answer. The only option which we are left with is unwaxed and thin floss. So, the answer is, the most preferred type of dental floss is unwaxed and thin floss.